The Libido Doctor is in.
Hello and welcome to Libido Doc, a place where we talk about human sexuality with a focus on married women. I'm Dr. Suzanne, and today I would like to talk about a virtuous and wise queen. Our example today is Queen Esther, and the two books of the Bible we're going to talk about are the book of Esther and the book of Proverbs. If you've not watched my previous video on the four faces of a wife extracted from the book of Ezekiel chapter 1 verse 10, which talks about the face of the eagle, the lion, the ox, and the feminine face, please watch that video because I will mention some of those characteristics in this video. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 8 and 9, we will extract what a wise queen is expected to do. The very first characteristic is the fear of the Lord. The Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So that's our very first characteristic. And even in Proverbs 31, it is said that the woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Okay? The second characteristic is the ability to take instructions from the Holy Spirit, from the Spirit of Wisdom. And by the way, I wrote a book titled Spirit of Wisdom, available on Amazon. Please get it, okay? You will not regret. Now, the third characteristic in Proverbs 8 and 9, especially Proverbs 9, is we see that the Spirit of Wisdom furnishes her table. So a wise queen should be able to know how to cook and to present the food, because you have to remember that our hands are anointed for such things, okay? So now, looking at the characteristic of a virtuous queen, we will mainly heavily look at Proverbs 31, okay? So, first characteristic, her husband trusts her all the days of her life. She does him good, okay? Second characteristic, she is smart and a hard worker. If you look at Proverbs 31, I believe almost 70% of all those verses talk about her hard work, her resourcefulness, her strength, you know, like the one of the ox, and how she's able to bring good things in the house, okay? That's what a virtuous queen does. She works hard, she uses her hands to produce, to increase income. Her children praise her because she's raising her children in the ways of the Lord, and they can see what the mother does. But also at the gate, her husband is praised, meaning that she works on his reputation, she amplifies him, she helps him with his divine mission and assignment, to the point where the quality of her work is shown in the actions she's taking. She's also a resourceful woman. Her household is protected. She's not afraid of the snow. She distributes, you know, work and food to her handmaid. She reaches out to the poor. She's compassionate. And she knows that through her hard work, through her smart work, her household is protected, okay? So the other part is the feminine part. We can see that she's a fashionista. She dresses well. She has luxurious clothes. She covers herself. You know, she doesn't just put all her stuff out anyhow. And there is a place there in Proverbs 31 verse 18. She knows she has good merchandise. Her candle goeth not out at night. And she uses her hands on the spindle and on the staff. Huh. Do you know what that means? It means that at night, she dresses up for the occasion. She is in that marital bedroom with her little candle, with her beautiful clothing, with her hands, you know, massaging her husband, giving him pleasure, because she knows she has good merchandise. You know, I'm from Cameroon, and we have a saying that women are nice. We say that in French. I don't even know how to translate that in English. But basically, is to say that you have a good packaging and good merchandise. That's what we say of beautiful women. We beautiful bodies, everything, place wherever it is. She knows she's beautiful, and she makes sure her king enjoys her. All right? So, the fear of the Lord, again, we see that in Proverbs 31. Now, how do we apply that in the case of Queen Esther? Looking at the background of Queen Esther, she was an orphan. She didn't have a father or her mother, but her cousin Mordecai, you know, took her in and treated her as his own daughter. So she was humble, but she was comfortable. You know, they were not poor, and she was very principled. When Queen Vashti was deposed, and the king's staff suggested that he looks for a new queen, one of the criteria was that the queen has to be a virgin. She had to be a virgin. We also read that Esther was beautiful. She was beautifully formed. She had a fair skin. She was beautiful to behold. Her face was gorgeous. She had a beautiful body, but she was still a virgin. What does it tell you? She was living with principles. She wasn't just going around having relationships here and there. She was a wise queen, okay? And that got her into the competition, because if she wasn't a virgin, hey, forget it. She wouldn't have been in that position, okay? So always remember that as a youngster, how you use your body. Be respectful of your own body. So the other thing, when she went to the palace, first she had favor with the king's staff. She got some of the best maidens, some of the best quarters and all that. She was well taken care of because she was having favor. Just looking at her, she was so gorgeous. They just wanted to favor her. But when it was her turn to go to the king, she did not require anything but what the king would like. What does that tell you? It's unconditional love. You don't go in with your selfish requirement, your selfish desires, but you go in to please the king, to make sure that you understand the vision, you understand the assignment, and you adjust yourself to that assignment. So when she went to the king with anything that would please him, she found favor with the king, and he loved her above everyone else, and he made her the queen. That's gorgeous. That's beautiful. Now let's look at Esther's divine mission. How does that start? Esther's cousin Mordecai, one day he gets at the gate. First of all, the gate was his assignment. That's where he worked, and that's where, you know, he was doing his function in the government. Mordecai one day gets to the gate, and he's very distressed. He has dirty clothes, he's sad, he's mourning, and all that. Esther is in the palace, and she hears about that, and sends her maiden with some clothing for her cousin to cover himself. And the cousin says, no, we are going through a crisis because there is someone called Haman who is releasing a decree to kill all the members of our community. And we really need Esther to step up. So Esther initially hesitates, and she's like, you know what? You don't really go to the king's presence if he doesn't call you. He can kill me and all that. Then Mordecai reminds her, maybe you are in the palace for such a time as this. But also remember, even if you do not want to do it, help will arise from a different quarter. What does that tell you? God has options. Vashti was deposed. Esther replaced her. If Esther doesn't want to do what God is calling her to do, someone else will do it. So, remember, be wise. Okay. So, after that exhortation, Esther decides to take on the challenge. But what does she do? She doesn't go to the king with entitlement because she's the queen and she can request what she wants. No. She goes to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and she humbles herself in prayer and fasting for 3 days, no food, no water. After the 3 days, when she receives instructions from the Holy Spirit, she's ready to face the king. And she, you know, puts on her beautiful queenly attire, and she goes in the presence of the king. And because she had prayed, God gives her favor to the king. He didn't kill her, but he asked her to come and request what she wants. So Esther tells the king, if I find favor in your eyes, please come to a banquet I will prepare, tomorrow, and come with Haman. Now, who is Haman? Haman is, I would say, the second in command in the kingdom. How did he get there? Let's go back. Mordecai, the cousin of Esther, who sits at the gate, one day overhear people plotting against the king, wanting to kill him. And he sends the news through Esther, so Esther could tell the king that there is a plot against him. And after investigation, the people are arrested, they are killed, and it's written in the books of the king that Mordecai saved his life. Interestingly, after all that, Haman is made like the second in command in the palace. And because of that, he wants to draw the honor of everyone. He wants people to bow to him. He wants people to honor him. But Mordecai refuses to bow to Haman because in his heart, he should only bow to God, to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And because of that, Haman gets very annoyed and decides to kill all the people, all the community of Mordecai. Because of one man, he wants to kill millions of people. So that's why Mordecai was so distressed and asking Esther to intervene for the people. So when Esther invites Haman to the banquet, she knows what she's doing. She's going after the enemy. She's embodying the lioness, going after the enemy. But Haman doesn't know that. He believes he's so privileged. Guess what? He didn't know what was going to happen. So Esther has the first banquet and she prepares the food herself. She mixes her wine. She prepares the bread. Remember in Proverbs 9, wisdom has prepared her table. Esther has the first banquet. She feeds them really well. The Bible says in Proverbs 25 verse 21 and 22. What do you have to do with your enemy? Feed them, give them food, because as you're doing so, you're putting coals of fire on their heads. So that first banquet was to put Haman on fire. After the banquet, he goes to his house, and because on the way, Mordecai again did not want to bow to him, he is so annoyed that he decides to build a gallows to kill Mordecai, you know, to get a decree and whatever, get the guy killed. He is so annoyed that his true face is coming out. And that's the food Esther prepared. Remember Psalm 144 verse 1 says, "It's God who teaches our hands to war and our fingers to fight." So even in the cooking, your hands are so anointed that whatever you pray, you cover that food with prayers. Your king is blessed, but your enemy is being destroyed. Meanwhile, the king is not able to sleep because all night he's trying to think, he thinks, and then he goes back to the chronicles of the king and the book, and he realizes that Mordecai saves his life, but he doesn't recall honoring him. So as the day breaks, he calls Haman and asks Haman, what shall be done to honor a man who did something great for the king? Of course, Mr. Haman, with all his pride, devises something spectacular because he thought he was going to be the one honored. But after he explains all that, the king says, okay, go do it for Mordecai. He was devastated, but he had to do it. Okay, so Mordecai was elevated, but we still didn't get to the real solution and the real divine mission of Esther. So she asked them to come for a second banquet. At the second banquet, the king asked her again, what do you want from me? I can give you half of the kingdom. She says, look, my lord, this is what's happening. Haman wants to kill me. What? So the king gets furious. And right there, he asked that Haman be arrested. So look at the strategy of Queen Esther. She didn't scream. She didn't make a demand. She did not complain, but she was following the instructions of the Holy Spirit with all her femininity, her beauty, you know, her being the wife who cooks, dresses a beautiful table, beautifies herself, be just delightful for the king. That's how she won him. That's how she killed her enemy, right? So after that second banquet, Haman is exposed and he is being killed by the gallows he had prepared for Mordecai. Isn't that beautiful? Your enemies will eat their own flesh and drink their own blood. Whatsoever they have decided against you, it must happen to them in Jesus' name. That was a parenthesis. Okay, so Haman is dead. And the king gives permission to Esther to take over Haman's house. She doesn't have peace, because she needs to get something done. She needs to protect the poor, the voiceless, the vulnerable, the people that are going to be killed if the decree is not reversed. So she goes to the king a third time and asks him to reverse the decree Haman had released to kill her people. And the king tells her, you know what? I can really do that because I already gave my word and my singlet was the seal of the decree. But I give you permission to write whatever you want to reverse that decree. Again, she uses her hands to battle. She writes the decree the way she wanted, even giving permission to her people to kill their enemies. And that's what happened, okay? So, after that, Mordecai was elevated even further. And Esther was also honored because her own work was talked about at the gate, just like we see in Proverbs 31. How the Feast of the Purim is being celebrated in honor of Esther. So in conclusion, what does it take to be a virtuous and wise queen? The very first thing is to fear the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Please go get my book on Spirit of Wisdom, available on Amazon. And pretty soon I'll have an audio version, and I'll update you when that is available, okay? So the fear of the Lord is the principal thing. Wisdom is the principal thing. Get it, get it, get it. and to go back to the four faces of a wife, you really can't survive if you don't understand those four layers, right? Your spiritual role, your role as a gatekeeper, the lioness, your role as the hard worker, the helper of your husband, the legacy keeper for your children, even the work you do with your hands to enhance your household income is very critical. And then the last but not least, your feminine self, your beautiful self, your delightful self for your king, of course, okay? Because he picked and chose you because he loves you. You feel his needs. You are the person he needs to help fulfill his assignment on earth. So never neglect your feminine side, okay? Well, thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned and enjoyed this presentation. And I'll see you next time. Bye.